Everybody be seated. No, not Pastor Rob. It's just shorter. 20 years old and about 3 pounds heavier. So, Pastor Rob. But I want you to know this is the day that the Lord has made. And so we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for this day. It's a beautiful day. Lord, we thank you because you woke us up and you gave us another opportunity to make anything wrong right. Father, somebody last night laid in a bed and asked you for one more chance. And for some reason, you said no. But you allowed us to be here to listen to your word. So, Lord, I ask that you would just hide me behind the cross, that you would get the glory out of anything that's said today. Father, I ask that something is said today that would just illuminate inside somebody, that would germinate and just grow. Because, Lord, we know that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord. It cuts going in and it cuts coming out. And God, it divides down to the marrow. So, Lord, your words are life. Let us grasp onto that. Bless us, Lord, and we will be blessed. Father, we love you because you first loved us. In your name we pray, amen. My name is Tony. I'm in here at Harvest. I live about a mile and a half up the street. I've lived there for 16 years and drove by this church almost every day and never came into it. I used to see the crowds. Something good was going on, but the Lord never impressed upon me to come in. I came in one time and the pastor wasn't even here. Him and his wife, they were there with somewhere else. But about 3 years ago, I came and I heard a young lady praying at another church. And I said to myself, oh, my goodness, where does she go? Church all the time. But this young lady prayed like she had been around the altar for a while. So I asked her where she went, and she said, this church here. And I was like, I live a mile and a half away from that church. So I started coming. I said, I've been married 46 years, and that right there gives my wife a free pass to heaven, even if she wasn't saved. I have two amazing daughters. I look at them and I wonder, where in the world did y'all come from? How'd my DNA get in y'all? I've got a son-in-law who is amazing. He's just like a son to me. I've got a brother-in-law who is amazing, just like a brother to me. My wife's sisters, they're amazing. I'm almost 70 years old. And my mom still alive. So you're looking at a blessed man. Somebody blessed far beyond what they deserve. But what I want to talk about today, I want to talk about something that we all have in common. Something that we all go through. And that's storms. If I had to put a title on it, I would say, sometimes your assignment is on the other side of the storm. Sometimes your assignment is on the other side of the storm. My text is in Mark 4th chapter, the 35th verse. I'm going to the 5th chapter, the 2nd verse. So it reads thus. 4:35 says, and the same day when the evening had come, he saith unto them, let us pass over to the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. 37. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say, Master, careth not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, "What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Now, there's two more verses that I'm going to read them later on. But let's go into this. 35th, and actually this day started earlier. Early in the morning. Jesus was actually teaching parables all day long. The first verse of this particular chapter, it says, "And he began to teach by the sea. And there gathered unto him a great crowd, so that he entered into a ship, and he sat in the sea, and the whole multitude was by the sea on the land." So Jesus is teaching parables, standing in the back of a boat or a ship, and speaking to the crowd. That's a terrible man right there. I find it hard just to sit here and talking to y'all. To stand in the back of a boat and project. That's why when I see these pictures of Jesus, these paintings of Jesus, where it looked like you could just blow him over, you know, he's got the little soft look, and he just looks like you just say boo, and he go run somewhere. That was not the Jesus that I know. Right. Jesus being a son of a carpenter, carpenters in them days didn't work with rugs and wool and whatnot. Carpenters worked with stones. He had to be a very strong physical man to break stones and to carry stones. Jesus was a man's man. So he's in the projecting, and he's teaching the whole crowd. And he's teaching them parables. And parables are stories that have a heavenly meaning. So the same day, in the 35th verse, the same day when the evening had come, he saith unto them, "Let's pass over to the other side." All these hours of teaching, it's nighttime. It's Jesus' idea to stay in the boat. It's Jesus' idea to go to the other side. Now, him being omniscient, he had to know that even though the sea looked calm then, that a storm was coming up. So he was telling them, "Let's go into the storm." A couple weeks ago, we were studying the book of Jonah. Jonah disobeyed God. And because he disobeyed God, he sent him into a storm. Here we have a situation where the disciples obey God, and he still sends them right into a storm. 36th verse says, "And they sent away the multitude." Every time you see the disciples sending away the multitude, they're always sending people away. But I love this next part. "But they took him even as he was." It's so important to take Jesus as he is. Take him as he is before you go into your storm. You'll be glad you did later. You got to take him as he really is, not how you think he is, not how you want him to be. Yeah. And the 37th verse says, "And there arose a great storm of wind." I can remember sitting in a watch night service in 2019. We're getting ready to go into 2020. And every time I turned on television, every time I looked up, they were talking about the new theme of 2020 is going to be, "I see clearly. I see the Lord moving clearly. This is the year 2020. I see clearly." Here comes March. Nobody saw what was coming. Nobody. Well, very, very few people. Things can happen suddenly. My wife and I were going to dinner one night, driving up I-64. I had my little gospel music playing in the car. We drive it along. I think she all of a sudden, at the corner of my eye, suddenly, I saw a vehicle literally spinning in the air, coming toward me. You know the partition that's in the middle of I-64? It hit the partition, and instead of going over, it went straight up in the air. All I could say was, "Jesus." And I looked up, and as I past, you can see the debris hitting the highway behind me. But it just goes to show you, your life can change in just a split second. Suddenly, the apostles, the disciples are on a calm sea, and then here comes a storm. Isn't that just like real life? Just like real life. They're on the Sea of Galilee. Now, the Sea of Galilee is in the Jordan Great Rift. And it's in the valley. So the sea is below a mountain range that surrounds it, about 2,000 feet. So the sea is prone to strong winds and violent moves of nature. This is what they were in right now. So a storm comes up, and the waves beat into the ship, and the ship is now full of water. So now let's talk about storms. Let's take a few minutes to talk about storms. Use this. If you look up storms in the dictionary, it's defined as a violent disturbance of the atmosphere with strong winds, usually rain, thunder, lightning, or even snow. A violent wind or a tempest. One definition was a whirlwind that throws everything topsy-turvy. Isn't that just like a storm? But now storms in the Bible, they often symbolize God's power and his awesome presence. A storm can represent difficulties, problems, loneliness, strength, weakness, and depression. Storms, let me tell you this right now. Storms will come into the life of every Christian. Every Christian. Whether you obey God or not. You right now where you are sitting, you're either in a storm, you just came out of a storm, or if you keep on laying down and getting up, you're going to be going into a storm. The Bible says there were other boats in the water. They experienced a storm too. So that lets you know when you go through this life, you're going to run into a storm whether Jesus is on your boat or not. But let me tell you, it's so much better to go through a storm when Jesus is on your boat. All storms have three things in common. They have a beginning, they have a middle, and they have an ending. So no storm, I don't care how bad it is. I don't care how bad it is. I don't care how bad it is you're going through. No storm lasts forever. That's why it's so important that you don't make permanent decisions for temporary problems. And it's so sad. You can Google prominent suicides or notable suicides, and you will be stunned to see how people that you and I think have everything to live for, everything to live for. They have attained the highest heights that you can reach as a person, as a human being, and still commit suicide. Now, there are reasons for storms. There are reasons for storms. One is because people are not always convinced by the sunshine or God's goodness or God's mercy that God sometimes sends a storm our way to get our attention. Now, storms in nature come to prune away dead things, unhealthy plants and unhealthy limbs and unhealthy branches, and they get rid of all the dead wood and unhealthy limbs from plants. And it does that because it helps things grow. The same thing happens in the spiritual world. God will send us a storm to prune us and to pull away dead things, unhealthy relationships. There's a train of thought going around now in churches where if you have enough faith, if you just have enough faith, that you will never go through a storm. That going through a storm means that you don't have enough faith to go through it. I'm telling you, that is not true. That is not true. If you just had enough faith, you wouldn't be going through what you're going through. That's not always true.
God will send a storm in a Christian's life for three things. One, to protect, just like Christ did with the disciples on the Sea of Galilee. To correct, like he did with Jonah. Or to perfect, which is what God sent a storm to Job for. And read the story of Job, you can see how he perfected him through storms in his life. The truth is, we are flooded with storms every single day. Internal, external. Storms come into our lives in many shapes and fashions. It could be your health. It could be your finances. It could be legal matters. It could be your relationship. The list can go on and on and on. But storms can clarify things that truly matter, and it can cloud up things that don't matter. It was a storm that clarified that Jonah needed to be thrown overboard. Storms may seem devastating sometimes, and I know when you're going through a storm, oh, Lord, have mercy. They can seem devastating, but God can use a storm to accomplish things that might not happen any other way. Storms can provide a clearing, a cleansing, a renewal, or a removal. The truth of the matter is, there's some lessons that can only be learned while you're going through a storm. A storm can teach you joy. Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord only in good times. Is that what it says? Oh, no. Rejoice in the Lord always. And then he repeats himself. And again I say, rejoice. A storm can teach you gratitude. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything give thanks. For this is the will of God concerning you. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus learned concerning you. A storm can teach you peace. In Philippians 4:6, the Bible says, or Paul says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your heart and minds in Christ Jesus. Let me tell you, 2 days ago, I received the worst telephone call that you can receive from a parent. My mother and father called us, the whole family. I have three brothers and a sister. And he gave us a report from the doctor that was not good. The doctor had to put a time limit on her life. We started out that Zoom call with prayer. It was a hard call to hear your mother say, the doctor told me this is all that I have to live. That was hard. That was so hard for me to hear this. And it chokes me up even now. The phone call started with a prayer. And my father's a bishop in Church of God in Christ. He started off the conversation with a prayer. And let me tell you, a peace came over us. So that by the end of the telephone call, we were laughing and joking. And making future plans that included my mother. There's a peace of God that you just cannot put words on. It passes your understanding. Not a calm. A calm is when you come home and the dishes are done and the yard is mowed and your bills are paid and the kids are acting right and your spouse is acting right. That's calm. Peace is what God gives you when you get the worst news that you could possibly get. And you look up and say, God, I don't understand. But even so, because it seemed good in your sight, I accept it. And he gives you a peace that you cannot put words on. A storm can teach you what's real and what's not real in life. Philippians 3:8 says, yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency for the knowledge of Christ, Jesus my Lord, for whom I suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung. Now, if you don't know what dung is, go Google it when we get out of here. But I can tell you, dung is what you flush down the toilet. Paul said, I consider any achievement that man gives me as dung compared to what I'm going to get for Christ. Our problem is we can only see like humans. I can only look at a snapshot of what you're going through. God sees the whole motion picture. So I would rather trade what God is going to give me than what I can receive from man. A storm can teach you strength. 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. I'm talking, a lot of these scriptures come from a man named Paul. Paul was a terrible man. Paul walked 10,000 miles in missions. He walked the distance between New York and California four times to spread the gospel. And if you want to read some things, in fact, I wrote them down. I was going to use them for a reference for me, but I'm going to read them to you. Paul, in the 11th chapter of Corinthians, he's talking to a group of people who are being influenced by some false teachers. And he's comparing his track record with their track record. Listen to what he says. He says, but I have served him, meaning Christ, far more. I've worked harder. I've been in prison more often. I've been whipped more often. I've been whipped with times without numbers and faced death again and again. Five different times, Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes. Three times, I was beaten with rods. Once, I was stoned. Three times, I was shipwrecked. Once, I spent a whole night and day adrift at sea in a storm. I've traveled many long journeys. I faced dangers from rivers, from robbers. I faced danger from my own people as well as from the Gentiles. I faced dangers in the city, in the desert, and on the seas. I've worked long and hard. I've endured many sleepless nights. I've been hungry, and I've been thirsty, and I've gone without food. Now, this is somebody who's gone through some storms. So when I come to God with my little showers, and I compare what some people, and this is only one person that you know, you can believe in the bottom of your heart that for every counterfeit you see somewhere, there's a genuine who's doing the things that Paul's doing and things that we all should be doing. Paul says he's praying to God, and he's talking in 2 Corinthians 12:19. He said, and he said unto me, meaning God said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Most gladly I will glory in my infirmities, that the power of God may rest upon me. The background of that scripture is a man who did all the things I just read. He asked God to remove an infirmity that he had. He asked him three times, and God said no three times to him. But he looked up and he said, okay, most gladly will I glory in the things that you aren't taking away from me. I'll be glad in them. A storm can teach you faith, and a storm can keep you, can teach you directions. Don't allow the storm to overshadow the fact that God is on your side. Don't let what you're going through overshadow the fact that he is for you and not against you. Isaiah 43, the second verse says, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. And when thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the fire kindle upon thee. The common thread through all that is that you're passing through. You're passing through all these things. You're passing through all these things. You're passing through all these things. No storm lasts forever. So you may ask me, what do I do to overcome a storm? Well, I'm glad you asked. Pray. The first thing, read and study your Bible. Read and study your Bible. If you know the words to your favorite songs and can't recite some scripture, you might need to read and study it a little bit more. Pray and fast. When Jonah was swallowed by the great fish, all you read about him and the fish is that he was praying. He was praying and quoting scripture. And that's always a good thing to do when you find yourself in a storm. And find yourself a good church. Find yourself a good church. Find yourself a church like this where they teach the word of God and where they live as best they can the word of God. Now, this church is not perfect because I'm going to it. So they're not perfect here because I'm here. But you will find out if you keep yourself around like-minded people, you'll find out that God can bring good out of anything if you let him. If you let him. He can bring good out of anything. But sometimes it's really hard to see the hand of God when you're in a storm. It's only when you're out of it and you look back and you can see God's hand was guiding, directing you the whole time. All right, so now we looked at storms. Let's get back to the story. Here's Jesus in the back of the boat. He goes on the boat and goes to sleep. He goes in the hinder part of the ship and goes to finds him a pillow and goes to sleep. Jesus wants us to be that way. Even in a storm, you can still look for peace. He went and went to sleep. And they awake him in the 38th verse. He was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and said unto him, Master, Master, care not that we perish. I can imagine when they got on the boat, some of the disciples were fishermen. So Jesus gets on the boat, and he's tired. He's been teaching all day. He goes in the back, and I'm sure they thought, okay, the Lord's tired. I'm a fisherman. I've been through a storm or two. I got this. I got this. And it reminds me of myself a lot of times. When I got the answer to prayer, okay, Lord, you can go on the back and go to sleep. I got this. When you get the healing that you needed, okay, I got my healing. Okay, Lord, you go on the back and go to sleep. I'm okay. I got this. They allowed him to go in the back and go to sleep. Do you have Jesus on your boat, but he's in the back, sleep? So why would Jesus get on a boat knowing they were going into a storm? Why would he allow them to go into a storm? He wanted them to go into the storm. That was the purpose of he wanted them to go into the storm because he wanted them to call on him and find out new things about him. So the lesson is that Jesus is on your boat and he's asleep. Go back and call him. Go on back there and call him. Call him. Verse 39 says, and he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He got up, he rose up, and he took his rightful place. He spoke to the elements just like he was talking to a person. And you know, he's given us that authority. We can talk to the elements just like they're people, just like it's a person. He told the wind to be quiet. And in modern terms, he told the wind to shut up. Shut up. But look at this. He slept through the wind beating up against the ship. He slept through the wind tossing the boat up and down. He slept through the waves beating up against the hull. He slept through the waves filling up the ship. But as soon as he heard the voice of somebody calling him that he loved, Master, he got up. He's just waiting for somebody that he loves, which is you, to call him. And he'll get up, and he'll get up in power. I'm telling you, he hears you when you're crying. Master, don't you care that I'm going down? Don't you see I'm losing my mind in this situation? Can't you see that I'm desperate? He sees and he hears all that. But you got to go to him. You have to call him. You have to take the initiative to do it. That's the way the principle is established. And when you're God, you can make your own principles. But that's the principle that he established. But now how he handled the storm is the way that we need to handle our earthly storms. The Bible says that he rebuked the wind and he said to the sea. He rebuked the wind and he talked to the sea. He rebuked the cause and he spoke to the symptoms. That's the way we need to approach our storms. The disciples looked at it and saw the waves and got scared, because the waves were overshadowing them. The waves were all that they could see. So they got afraid by seeing the waves filling up the boat and thought that they were going under. Jesus got up and saw that the cause of the waves was the wind. We need to rebuke the cause of our storms. We need to find out that we are fighting a spiritual battle. And even though it seemed like the waves were the main cause of the problem, it was the wind that was causing the problem. So he rebuked the wind. Many times we react to the symptoms in our marriages and in our relationships, and our finances, when we need to be rebuking the cause of it. Ephesians 6:12 says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. So if you wonder why everything is falling apart, just what we're doing is we're fighting against the symptoms. We're in it, we're just lashing out at them. Your children acting up, your spouse acting up, and we lash out against the symptoms when the cause of it is the fact that we need Jesus. We need to be saved. That is the cause. If you rebuke the cause of your problem, the cause of the storm, the symptoms will follow. The symptoms will cease. Jesus looked at him in the 40th verse. He says, and he said unto them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Don't you care that we perish? But in this storm, just like all other storms, we got to realize God controlled the storm. He always had the storm under control. And Jesus was with them throughout the whole storm. So all they had to do was cry out to God, because he was already on the scene. Jesus asked, why are you so fearful? And I'll be honest with you, I struggled with this part here, because I don't know, was Jesus asking, why didn't you call me sooner? Or why didn't you calm the storm yourself? Or why did you even call me at all? Because you knew I was on the boat. I told you, let's go to the other side. Didn't you know you were going to make it? I struggle with that because I see myself in that. And I asked myself, if I was on the boat, where would I be? Would I be running down there with the disciples saying, Master, don't you care that we perish? Or would I be beside Jesus saying, let me have some of that pillow, man, because I'm tired too. You said we was going to the other side. Sometimes I don't like the answer that I have to give myself because I'm being honest. But look at Jesus. He rebuked them, but he didn't abandon them. He got upset with them, but he still answered their call. He waited for them to call. He heard them when they called. He rose. He acted. He answered. And he heard their cry. So if you're in a storm and you feel like you're going down, call. Just call. He'll get up. He'll answer your call. But you have to go to him for help. A father once told his son to clear a field. The field was full of debris and rocks. The son went down there and did a great job. He removed all the debris, but there was one rock on the edge that he pushed and he pulled. And he tried every trick that he could to get this rock off the field, but he just couldn't do it. His father came down and said, well, son, you did a great job. He said, Dad, I did the best I could. I did everything you asked. That rock, I just could not move that rock. I pushed, I pulled, I tried all the tricks you taught me. His father looked at him and said, well, did you do everything that you could to move it? He said, Dad, I did everything I could to move it. His father looked at him and said, no, son, no, you didn't. You didn't ask my help. All you had to do is ask my help. And that's the way God looks at us a lot of times, I imagine. We try all the tricks that we can to get out of our storms, all the tricks of the trade, when God says, all you got to do is come to me and ask for help. I'm right here. I'm right here. Verse 41, and they feared exceedingly, and they said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the seas obey him? The disciples were frightened, they were fearful, and they were faithless. They were all those things, but they were smart enough to go to Jesus when they got in trouble. That's what we need to remember. You can be all those things, but don't be so foolish that you don't go to him. There are some lessons that only can be learned in the storm, because you see, this was the first time they actually looked at him in those eyes, that they feared him, they marveled at him. And it was a lesson that only could have been learned in that storm, a storm that he sent them into. I told you in the beginning, the title of this was, sometimes your assignment is on the other side of the storm. Let's look at Mark, the fifth chapter, the first and the second verse. Mark 5, 1 and 2. Mark 5, 1 says, and they came over to the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadareans. So the verse 1 let us know that they did make it to the other side just like Jesus told them. Verse 2, and when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. This is what I want you to get. He stepped right off the ship on the other side of the storm, right into his assignment, right into what God had him to do. If he had taken them around the storm, it would have taken them too much time, and they would have missed the man. If he had stopped the storm too soon or prevented them from going into the storm in the first place, they would have got there too fast, and they would have missed the man. They would have missed their assignment. It was only by going through the storm and learning the lesson that Jesus had for them to learn that as soon as he stepped off the boat, he stepped right into his assignment. Today, somebody is wondering, why am I in this storm? Why have I been in this? Why is this happening to me? Why is this so long? I'm telling you, God has something for you on the other side of the storm. I was on the Monitor Merrimack Tunnel. The sun was shining. It was a beautiful day. But right off to the left, I saw all these storm clouds. And it was raining. It looked like sheets of rain was coming down and lightning. Now, to the people that were in the storm over there, that's probably all they saw was the rain and the wind and the storm. But me on the outside, I could see that if they just hung in there a little bit longer, that the storm was going to pass and that the sun was going to shine again. Let's all stand. I just want you to know, it doesn't matter what things look like right now, what you're going through. It's all a part of the master plan. Nothing in your life ever took God by surprise. Every storm that you go through was mapped out before time began. When you get to heaven, you're going to be stunned when you find out how many times you went left what you thought by accident, when if you went right, there was disaster up the road. God has your life mapped out. To those of you who Jesus is not on your boat, today is the day that you can ask for him to be on your boat too. Because the storm's going to come, whether he's on your boat or not. Make sure he's on your boat. All he wants you to do is just call him. Just call him. Just call him. Call him, and he will answer your prayer. He will calm your storm. He will tell you how to react to the cause of the situation, the cause of the storm, and not just the symptoms. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. Lord, it's a good day. It's a good day, and we are so grateful for it. Father, if there's anybody here today who doesn't have you on their ship, under the sound of my voice, let them know that all they have to do is ask. Ask you to come into your life, and that you are already waiting for them. And that, God, you will teach and navigate them all through the storms of this life. I tell you, we serve a good God. We serve a good God. We serve a good God. And no matter what it seems like on the news, the bad news that we hear, we know that storms don't last always. And that, Lord, you're just waiting for us to come to you. You are the master of the storm. You are the master of the elements. And that you have our lives in your hands. Father, we thank you. We love you. Because you first loved us. Can we just praise him just for a minute? Father, we thank you. Just praise him just for a minute. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Thank you.
As long as I am breathing. worship the Lord. As long as I am breathing, I will always worship you. Any upcoming singers, we would love to have you have a desire to sing. Please come out this Thursday at 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. We're going to go through a lot of songs, and we would love to have you come and join us. Amen. I just want to thank the Lord for today's word. You know, God is a good God, and the Lord, He sees you in your storm. And so the Lord is going to have a blessing for you on the other side of the storm. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen.
Before we go, are there any first-time visitors here? So we are all family here. God bless you. I thank you for sitting here listening to me. And I tell you, this has been an honor. This has truly been an honor. And I just feel humbled being up here. God bless you. We're going to follow social distancing when we can leave. So if everybody stands up, we can go exit to our right. And also, notice the sign up there. We have a men's fishing trip Saturday, October 16th. If you are interested in, please speak to either Brother Harold McLean, the gentleman back there in the yellow. The trip is $190, but you will do some deep sea fishing. It's going to be worth it. It's going to be worth it. God bless you. God bless you. Have a great day today. Praise the Lord, everybody. Let's sing our little song.